look this up.
Yeah.
Okay.
But no, I don't, it was a long time ago.
Yeah, didn't.
Okay, everybody has to sit. She's up there.
Pins got that much, right?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, it's a lovely day, and I think it's only going to get colder as the week goes on, so I'm told. So we'll live it up while we can. I'd like to welcome you all to First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ in St. Albans. We're a welcoming community of spiritual seekers, believers, and doubters. And whether you are joining us online, on cable TV, or in the sanctuary, please know that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here to journey with us. As a couple of announcements this morning, this is the last Sunday that you can drop off donations for Ada's Closet. You'll see envelopes and information back in a narthex. This year, we're not buying poinsettias for decorating the altar. Instead, we are giving to a very good cause that helps teenagers in need. The Mitten Tree is still taking donations. You can see it continues to grow. So if you have a crafter in your life or you feel like knocking out a scarf or a hat in the next day or so, bring it on in. And finally, I just wanted to let you all know that this month, really since Thanksgiving, we were able to help two families in need over the holidays. And I just wanted to thank everyone for their generous support to the pastor's discretionary fund that helped that happen. So thank you. Would you please join me for this morning's opening prayer? Greatly rejoice in the Lord. Bring good news to the oppressed. Bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, comfort all who mourn. Greatly rejoice in the Lord.
Thank you.
show where work is to be done. Let a community of builders be formed in the light of joy. Let joy find home in our hearts and make space for your presence there as we work for justice and peace and the love and service of love.
God be with us in this light of joy. Please join me for the prayer of confession. If you're able, please stand. Merciful God, we know that you love us and that you call us to fullness of life. Be around us and within us. We see the brokenness of our world and our ways. Forgive our willful neglect of your world, our insensitivity to the needs of others, and our failure to feed the spirit that is within us. Restore us to a joy-filled path of hope and peace. Amen. God's love is unwavering. It's eternal. God's blessing has been poured out for all of creation. And nothing can separate you from that blessing. Nothing can separate you from God's love. Be reminded of that today and every day. Praise be to God. This morning's scripture is John chapters 1, 6 through 8, and 19 through 28. There is a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you a prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am a voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Has anyone here been baptized? By and large, a lot. What is baptizing? Why do we baptize? Well, that's a good question, because it's not really clear. In many ways, we baptize as a way of marking somebody's entrance into the community of faith. So, for instance, I come from a Catholic background, and my sister still is Catholic, and I am the godmother of her daughter, my niece. And I went and participated in the ceremony when the niece was about 2. She was a little older than infants. So she was a very persnickety child, and still is at 19, very fussy, determined, self-aware, let's just say. So she's pitching a fit during all the baptism, and she's sort of looking at the priest like, "Who are you, and why are you like getting my head wet and oiled and crossing?" But then after that ceremony, he picked her up and he carried her, and he started on this side, and he walked all around the church, up and down each aisle, and everybody in their pews came out, and they all sort of shook her hand or touched her or greeted her. And And it was such a warm and loving experience. And I thought, this child went from having a family of, you know, a mom and a dad and grandparents, but not a big extended family. We're a small family. And suddenly, she had 80 people in her family, in this really special relationship that we have in a faith community. And so that, I feel, is baptism for us. And I think, in a way, this morning's scripture, when John is talking about baptizing and letting people know that Jesus is coming, he's sort of naming Jesus and bringing Jesus into the community that he will lead and that has been brought together for him. I'm fascinated by communication. I'm fascinated by these rituals. The ritual of baptism is such a symbolic, fully, deeply meaningful, I don't know, rite of passage that we go through. We as human beings, we can create and communicate all sorts of information, from the concrete to the very abstract. We communicate with language, but we also communicate with numbers. You think about ones and zeros and everything that has been accomplished with ones and zeros in all of our little devices that we love. We communicate with words and we communicate with symbols. And symbols may or may not be words. We communicate through art and through music. And we just heard Stefan's lullaby. Think about that communication, that heartfelt, soulful communication. If we didn't communicate, would we have war? Could we have peace without language? I wonder what that moment was when the first human being decided to talk about something that wasn't there. Talk about something that was to happen in the future. How did that conversation go? I'm wondering if that poor person looked up and saw a lot of people's faces with these big question marks. What are you talking about? I wonder how that first human conversation went about God or Atman or Creator, the universe. As humans, we're driven to explore. We want to suss out the world around us and the world that we don't see. We're driven to figure out our place in life in this infinite universe. According to early 20th century Swiss psychiatrist and psychoanalyst Carl Jung, we move into the use of symbols, which can be word or image, when we want to explore one of the great unknowables. This is a quote. "Thus, a word or image is symbolic when it implies something more than its obvious and immediate meaning. It has a wider unconscious aspect that is never precisely defined or fully explained. Nor can one hope to define or explain it. As the mind explores the symbol, it is led to ideas that lie beyond the grasp of reason." I love that. As the mind explores the symbol. "The wheel may lead our thoughts toward the concept of a divine sun. To the point where reason must admit its incompetence. Man is unable to define a divine being. When all our intellectual limitations, with all our intellectual limitations, when we call something divine, we are merely giving a name which may be based on a creed, but it's never not factual evidence. Because there are innumerable things beyond the range of human understanding, we constantly use symbolic terms to represent concepts that we cannot define or fully comprehend. This is one reason why religions This is one reason why religions employ symbolic language or images. That's from Approaching the Unconscious by Carl Jung. So we employ symbolic language or images to explore the unknown. And that's what we do here. We grapple with the realm that is really beyond our grasp. We have four gospels, four, and they all tell the same basic story, but each with different shades of meaning, different perspective. And they all work together, like the wheel Jung mentions, to lead our thoughts toward a place, an explanation of Christ, of divinity, and how we as mere humans fit into that mix. John the Baptist, the man, has, by the time the Gospels are written, become symbolic. And the Gospel of John has a slightly different take on John the Baptist than the others. Last week we talked about the Gospel of Mark. In Mark, John looks and acts like the prophet Elijah, and he's typically understood to be an Elijah figure. So he's Elijah to Jesus' Messiah. This is not the case in the Gospel of John, where John the Baptist's role is as a primary witness to Jesus, a witness to that divinity. John's Gospel opens with the familiar lines, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This one was in the beginning with God." The Word is Jesus. And Jesus is the Word incarnate. This week, we meet John the Baptist again for the first time through the Gospel of John, which, if there's any confusion with younger folks, John the Baptist is not the same as the Gospel writer, John. Here we get a different story. In the Gospel of John, John is not the baptizer, though he's baptizing. And he is specifically asked if he is Elijah. He says no. He's specifically asked if he's the prophet. He says no. And he says he is not the Messiah. So they ask him, "Who are you?" John the Baptist is not a sign or a symbol of the coming of the Messiah in and of himself. Here, he is a human witness to Jesus. He came as a witness to the light, the Gospel writer writes, so that others might believe through him. That is to say, in this Gospel, when John the Baptist says, "Make straight the way of the Lord," he's talking about something that's not about preparing people for Christ by helping them to create an internal change or internal readiness. It's about telling people who Jesus is, telling them that Christ is on his way. John the Baptist is the first person in this gospel who calls Jesus the Son of God. And it happens early in the story, before Jesus has even gathered his disciples or performed any miracles. John has a God-given understanding of Jesus' identity. The priests and Levites came from Jerusalem to ask, "Who are you?" And it's important because John had quite a following, so they needed to find out who he was. People were coming from all over to hear him preach and to be baptized by him, so they were interested. "Who are you?" they ask him. He says, "I'm not the Messiah. Elijah? Nope, I'm not. The prophet? No." "Then what do you say about yourself?" "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness." "Who are you?" When the priests ask John if he is the Messiah, Elijah, or the prophet, they're talking about very specific religious symbols with very specific meanings. They're trying to pin John the Baptist into a context with which they are comfortable and familiar. It's so important as humans be able to put a name to something. It gives the illusion of understanding. So in a sense, John is asking them to break with those preconceived ideas and definitions. No, I'm not going to say that I'm Elijah. No, I'm not a prophet. This is something new. Who are you? We get asked that a lot. Are we a doctor, a lawyer? What does that mean, these definitions? What does it mean to you as the individual, or to others looking at you, or how you perceive others? How many judgments do we make immediately when we hear someone defined by their job or their spouse or their situation in life? Oh, he's an alcoholic. She's homeless. I'm a minister. We like to define ourselves, and we're comforted by those boundaries. They help save us, I think, from existential crisis. If we compare ourselves to the size of the universe and describe ourselves that way, it gets really scary. To me, it almost seems like a Monty Python sketch joke. I am but a speck. I am nothing. You're not so small. But we are something, and we all know that. It's unnameable. It's the part of us that is eternal, the seemingly infinite, the thing that is our essential self, that marks me as me, you as you, and at the same time connects me with you, and you with me. I'm going to call this thing the soul. And this is the home of our essential self. This is the home of compassion. It's the home of peace and hope. It's the home of joy. And yes, we are and do many things. Wife, pastor, aunt. But that is not it. The essential self is a place of proper proportion where we can rest and reflect. The definitions that tend to pigeonhole us in a superficial way don't speak to who we are in our hearts or in our souls. John the Baptist knows this. He's a voice crying out in the wilderness. He's confident in his purpose and his mission, and he doesn't need the world to think that he's more than that voice in the wilderness. I imagine that gave him a kind of freedom and a kind of joy in his life. For me, the question is less about who I am and more about how can I live my life more like John the Baptist? How can I live my life confident in who I am, in proper proportion to the world? How do we live into our true selves, to our true purpose and joy? So who are you? And how do you live into your life's purpose? Amen. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Holy One, listen to our prayers and our concerns and joys this morning. Do we have any concerns this morning that you would like to share?
Been an active member in our choir.
proper proportioned life, right? Prayers for Flossie.
I'd like to have prayers for a friend of mine and his wife, Richard and Betsy Baker, for their loss of her, his wife's wife. She died at 103 of COVID-19 the other day. And also a prayer for my two parents, my father James and my mother, Reverend Laura McElroy, for the Christmas time.
More concerns? I'm wondering if we could have a moment of joys on this Joy Advent Sunday. That's a great joy.
He's in the army and we're very proud of him.
Any other joys this morning? Yeah, it's a joy to be able to meet separated in mass though we are. In the spirit of prayer, let's hold these things close to our hearts, what we've mentioned this morning and the folks in need of prayer and healing in this Christmas time. Hold our joys up to be shared as beacons of hope and light. Yes, also to hold close to your hearts those unspoken prayers. Holy One, as we walk through Advent, help us to live in hope, peace, and joy, despite the many challenges of our world, the continuing pandemic, the aftermath of hurricanes in Central America, systemic racism, environmental destruction. We pray especially for those who are living in isolation, for those struggling with loss, for the addicted, the lost, and the vulnerable. We pray for your guidance in all of these things. Grant us peace and understanding. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Now join me for the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go in peace and love and joy. Love each other and know you are not alone in this world, but we journey together on this great path. Amen.